Seacrest.
I think Seacrest gave me a back rub for a second, and I said over it. Hey, it's Thursday, November 17th, and Ryan Seacrest is back today.
Good to be here. Thank you very much.
Amazing.
Well, thank you.
I love everything you're wearing right now. Well,
I appreciate that. I can only wear turtlenecks here on the East Coast, so I will not be able to wear this in Los Angeles.
I'm afraid to ever wear a turtleneck again because I wore a turtleneck yesterday on the show, and there were so many comments about how big my head looked.
I actually noticed that you wore one yesterday, which is why I felt comfortable wearing one today, but I might get the same kind of comment.
Don't be alarmed.
I think my head looks small in this, though. It swallows me a little bit.
I do have
a Kelly, my head is not that small.
It's smaller than Kelly's. Well, everybody's head, Macy's floats are smaller than my head. I have a large head. I'm amazed my mom survived childbirth.
I have a fashion question for you as a woman, because I'm confused about men and socks.
Okay.
So my mother, who's here, you'll meet her later. She's going to cook oyster casserole. Connie Seacrest. She got my dad and I these little booties that you put in your shoes so you don't look like you're wearing socks. So today, I don't know if you can see.
I like it. I like it very much. It's very...
Put my feet on the table?
Yes, put your feet on the
today,
table.
Today, I'm wearing the booties, but...
Yeah. Can you get the ankle shot? Can we get...
There you go.
Oh, look at that. Good
and
ankle.
I see every once in a while, I see men doing this. I'm not so sure this is my look.
You know...
It's a summary look.
Am I late in the season?
Yeah, turtlenecks and that doesn't come.
Turtlenecks and ankles don't go together, Art? All right,
well,
thank you.
Well, listen, I don't listen to them.
The fashionista, he does look pretty good.
No, I wouldn't listen to anything.
So what do you think?
So let me just say this. If you really want to master the art of not wearing socks, you've got to look at Bryant Gumbel. Bryant Gumbel is one of these formal, put-together fellows, such as yourself, nattily attired, really polished.
Right.
And he has mastered the art of not wearing a sock.
Okay, so.
And you've got to see the way he does
it. Real sports.
Check it out. He does it in a way that is very, very, very effortless, and it all makes sense. You're almost there.
I'm not sure if these
shoes with the no socks.
Okay.
Work. I'm not sure.
First commercial, I'll change for you.
Okay. We should. That would be fun to do, though. By the way.
Just change clothes.
Yeah, that would be fun.
How was your night last night?
It wasn't as fun as your night last night. We texted each other last night and exchanged photos with what we were both doing at that time.
Yours looked much more intense than mine.
Well, show everybody what you did.
Okay. So last night. The greatest thing in the world is when you're at work, you're at your desk, and somebody sends flowers or a card, or you're in a restaurant, and someone sends over a bottle of boutique champagne, as did someone last night to my mother and I, who were on a mother-son date.
Where?
It's called the Clam.
The Clam?
Yeah, where they serve seafood, imagine.
Wait, where is the Clam?
The Clam is West Village.
Okay.
So we walked, it was a beautiful night last night, we walked there, we sat down, and I said, well, who is that champagne from? The one and only Kelly Ripa.
I wanted to thank your mom. That was really nice of your mom to come in and do a cooking segment, since my mom won't.
So anyway, compare this.
He sends me this picture, and I said, really, I wish I was with you two, because this is what I've got going on. I'm soul cycling.
So well, you this were was spinning
post,
last night.
This was post soul cycle. That's why my hair is wet, and somehow sweat was still pouring out of my face.
You look beautiful even with the shine.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
I find it difficult to do this at night when you have to go to sleep.
I got really busy yesterday. My son is graduating 8th grade this year, and he's going to be going into high school, so we're trying to find a high school for him. So my husband and I have been taking high school tours.
Right.
So that pushed my entire... Usually I work out in the day. I don't like to work out when it's dark. It makes me somehow stay up all night eating food because I feel like I have to. I better eat another plate of ravioli. I sponge tonight. So everything got pushed back late. That's why I was working out late, because I don't typically do that.
Just so you know, we did not feel guilty, so.
No, I know, I know. You know what we did do last night after I got home? Mark and I finished binge watching Stranger Things.
Oh, yes.
Have you seen this show?
Yeah. It takes place in the 80s.
Yes, it takes place in the 80s, so it appeals to... First of all, my kids are like, what is that? I'm like, that's a telephone.
That's great.
What is that supposed to be? Those are walkie-talkies. Like, my kids, they think that this whole show takes place in outer space. I'm like, no, it's just the 80s.
Just a few years ago.
But it's a really good show.
Yeah, I started to watch that. I got through a couple. Do you normally binge? Do you get through a lot at once?
What we'll do is we will watch, like, in two to 3 days, we'll watch an entire season of something. Mm-hmm. That's what we do. Because we don't watch a lot of TV, just like certain things.
Just when you have a window of time to do it?
Yeah.
All right, so something I wanted to share with all of you and you, Ms. Ripa, I thought was interesting. In today's paper, I read this article. Mm. So Bob Dylan, you guys know Bob Dylan?
We've heard of him.
Yes.
He's an up-and-comer.
He is an up-and-comer. He was to be awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for Literature.
Yes, I think
first musician to win this.
That's kind of an amazing feat.
Huge. And so you would think that when you find out that you're going to win that, immediately you respond with some sort of press release or some sort of tweet or something.
Right.
He didn't. It took him a few weeks to acknowledge that he was going to get
this. They couldn't find him or something.
Yeah,
I kept following
him. He was snorkeling somewhere. So he then eventually replied that he was speechless, so obviously very honored.
Hence the silence.
And so today in the paper, he's now saying he cannot accept in person because he is booked. Oh. So he's unavailable to receive the Nobel Peace Prize.
He's got a gig.
Have you ever met Bob Dylan?
No. Have you? Yes, you've met everyone. tell us, Ryan, everything.
So I can tell you everything, but not because I've met him.
Okay.
Bob and I have the same dentist. Oh. Yes, even better than knowing him, dentist.
That actually is better than knowing him.
And so I don't want to out the dentist, but I've been going to him for a long time. He's since retired recently, but every time you go in, he's got Bob Dylan pictures all over the wall, and he'll tell you great stories about Bob Dylan.
That's incredible.
None of which I can tell on this show, because it's live.
Right.
But it's my closest connection. I've never met the man.
Oh, my gosh. I don't even know what I would say to him if I met him.
I don't think we would understand what he would say to us.
I know. We wouldn't understand him anyway. Yeah, I would love to meet him, though. That would be a
total legend.
He's a person that, you know, doing this job, you meet a lot of people. And eventually, you meet a lot of people who know a lot of people. So eventually, you'll hear stories from people who know people who know people. Radio silence with Bob Dylan. I don't know a single person that knows him or has met him.
Next time you need a teeth cleaning, you know exactly where to sign you up, Kelly. Yeah.
So you're closer than I am to Bob Dylan.
One dentist away.
Gosh, these dentists, man, they know stuff. They know things. You know, because my dentist has told me stories about...
Gossip
about...
Give us some good gossip.
Well, no, I just know there's a group. I know a group, and I can't tell you the group, but the group...
Bon Jovi.
No.
It's Bon Jovi.
I know. Everything to me is Bon Jovi because I'm from New Jersey. So I'm like, I know a group and they're like, Bon Jovi.
For sure.
Okay, no, not that group. But he said that they would come in and do the laughing gas and then write songs. And they thought they were writing like genius, lyrical genius stuff. And then they would come out of the laughing gas and it was gibberish. Like they were writing gibberish. Nothing made sense.
Def Leppard? I'm trying to figure it out. All right, so Thanksgiving is, a week away?
Can
you believe
God.
That? Thanksgiving a week away.
A week away! I know, I'm excited. I'm excited for your mom's recipe, by the way. This is something I've never had before.
As a kid, I thought stuffing was boring, so we came up with this oyster casserole stuffing, which you'll see. It may sound a little gross, but just bear with us. So almost 50 million Americans expected to travel this year for Thanksgiving, which is, that's a lot. And something I wanted to run by you was, when you travel in the air, they have this list of do's and don'ts in the paper today.
Yeah, okay.
This is an air travel don't column. don't do yoga in the galley. Do you ever do yoga when you get, do you ever get stiff and do yoga in the galley?
I've not done yoga in the galley.
No tree
no.
out there in the?
No.
Okay. No tree with the ankles?
I don't believe anybody wants to see my crotch.
Have you ever seen people, though, get up and stretch? And
oh, I've
up?
Seen a lot of things on, listen, there's an entire Instagram page called passenger shaming. Passenger
yes,
shaming.
I've heard you talk about
I'm
this.
Telling you,
you're obsessed.
It's my husband follows them, and I stalk them because I haven't committed fully to the follow because I know that if I do, I'll never be able to travel again. Yeah. But they shame passengers who do disgusting things.
Like, give us a good example of something totally
like
disgusting.
Like clipping their toenails.
Ah.
Clipping their toenails.
Funny you should mention that.
You see another passenger's head, like, because there's a head here, and the foot's up here, and the person's clipping.
Oh,
and
that's
you're like,
disgusting.
Who's taking that picture?
But that's on the list. It says don't clip your toenails.
Yeah, right.
It says do clip your toenails in the bathroom.
Or at home.
Yeah, maybe before you go. Good idea. Even better. Even better.
Or at home. It's like, geez, I really, really need a pedicure. I'm going to wait for that JetBlue flight. I'm going to wait. You know what? I've got all this time here at home.
No, no, not now.
I'm going to wait.
Wait for some connections.
Because I definitely may need to utilize my toenails when I go through airport security. So I'm going to, I'm going to
42,000 feet and personal hygiene, the perfect combination.
Yeah, yeah. Now going home, when you go home, are you, see, when I go home to visit my parents, they, even though they say they have the Wi-Fi and it's plugged in over there. This is what they say. Because I'm like, you guys don't have Wi-Fi? And they're like, yeah, we do. It's plugged in over there. But we're not sure how to get on it or how it works. But they keep pointing.
So they're pointing. It's
over there.
Over
there uh-huh. And they go, it's plugged in right over there.
But shouldn't it work from right over here?
They don't know.
In?
They don't know their passcode and they don't even know what that means. So anyway, so there's that. And so they're saying that people crave Wi-Fi more than chocolate, alcohol, and sex.
Wow.
And
they love Wi-Fi.
Two out of three.
Okay, lady in the audience, you're an expert. Which one do you crave more than Wi-Fi, chocolate, alcohol, or sex?
I would rather have the sex, I'm sorry.
She said she would rather have the sex. Ask her if she's single.
Lady, are you single? Ryan would like to know.
My mom's in town, but she goes to bed early.
I'll take your mom out tonight. I'll take her out tonight.
Good team
I'll take
effort.
Her out of town. Okay, good. Good for you. Lady, you stay right there.
Yes.
Do not move. Yeah, so isn't that amazing that 40% said they would choose Wi-Fi?
We Jones with our phone. I mean, we need to be connected at all times.
I love to not be connected, though.
You do?
I love to disconnect. So, I'm a good disconnector.
I'm going to try and do for my resolution for New Year's a digital diet where I don't check my phone for a half day or a day.
But you're a high-functioning person.
What does that mean?
So there are people in the world that are high-functioning.
I'm confused.
No, I'm going to tell you. The most successful people in the world that I've known, my most successful friends, of which I consider you one.
Oh, thank you.
You
new friends.
You email them or you text them and they respond almost instantaneously in real time. Text message Anderson Cooper. He could be in the middle of a broadcast and you see him like broadcast.
By the way, that is
and
true.
And you know he's responding to you in real time. And I go, how did you just do that? You're on the air. He's like, I don't know. I can use both sides of my thumbs and brain. And so, and I have a lot of friends that are high functioning yeah. that can really, really dial in and do their jobs and respond to you. And they are just a higher elevated people. I am mid to low level functioning.
Oh, let me tell you, last night you responded every time very quickly.
That was accidental. I was having a good day. But there are times where it could take me 24, 48 hours to respond to something. So
I'm going to try and become you.
Okay, good.
I'm going to try that.
All right. Well, but anyway, back to the lady. 37% would rather have sex than Wi-Fi, and 14% would. 37.
I don't even care about Wi-Fi.
She doesn't care.
All right, she doesn't care about Wi-Fi at all. And 14% choose chocolate.
All right.
There you go.
I like her. She's comfortable in her own skin.
Yeah. I like her too. You two are going to make a nice couple. I'm excited. I'm excited about it. Yeah.
All right, what do we have today? Today on the show, we got Dennis Quaid is here.
Dennis Quaid is here. Who else? Tell me everything.
I'll tell you everything I know.
Ryan, everybody that's here today. Tell me everything.
I think also from This Is Us, Sterling K. Brown.
Oh,
this
my God. Yes, and from OJ, yeah. He played Christopher Darden.
Yes. Amazing. Yes. That series, amazing.
Yep. And we continue Live's homestyle Thanksgiving week when Ryan's mom shares her favorite recipe for Christmas.
Very exciting.
About the Seacrest. This is my number one like about the Seacrest.
She's so excited to see you.
You're a cheese-eating family. You like cheese.
Yeah. We're Swiss.
I'm not Swiss, but I should be because I love cheese so much.
I've made a whole career out of being cheese.
I disagree.
All right.
I disagree. Okay, you ready? It's time.
Not the crew. They're laughing. Are we ready?
Laugh at anything.
Okay, here we go.
It's time for Live's a Party Travel Trivia.
Let's do it.
From Belmore, New York. Good job, Trisha.
Nice moves.
You look adorable. Were you preparing to be our trivia dancer today? Yes. Atta girl. I still have confetti in here.
Oh, you're happy to be here.
Guys, I only half fired my wand. Hey, let's say hi to Robin Nicholson from Rochester Hills, Michigan.
Hello, Robin, how are you?
Doing well. Good morning, Kelly and Ryan.
Good morning.
How are you, Robin?
I'm doing great. I'm going to be putting up Christmas decorations today outside because it's a beautiful day in Michigan.
Oh, great.
Is that a picture of today?
Oh, no. Oh. That is a picture of Walt Disney World in February.
Okay. Oh. That was my second guess, actually.
Oh, yeah, I can see now the big...
The Epcot
Center.
Yes, so cool. All right, let's spin the wheel, see what you're playing.
All right, here we go.
And win your trick.
Okay, thank you.
Regency Huntington Beach Resort and Spa in California. 7 days, 6 nights. It includes one spa treatment per person. This trip is provided in part by Hotels.com. It's a prize valued at $4,400. You have 20 seconds and only one guest, Robin. Good luck.
Okay, here we go, Robin. Focus now.
Okay.
All right. Earlier this week, Robert Wagner appeared on the show. What actor did Robert say played his son on television? Here we go. Clock is ticking.
Oh my God.
Oh.
Moaning is a good sign. It's coming.
Robert Wagner's son.
Yeah. On television.
TV.
5 seconds.
Take a guess.
I don't know.
Oh my God.
What's your son's name?
Robert.
Oh, your son's name's Robert? It's not Robert.
No.
Sorry.
It's Michael Weatherly.
You know that.
Oh.
Yes.
See how it all comes to you after we give you the answer? Listen, Robin, you're still going to get a great prize. You and a lucky member of our studio audience will each receive a $500 gift card from Walmart.
Nice.
So please take a number. Walmart photo. Sorry.
Right.
Sorry. Walmart photo.
Yes.
Didn't want you to get too excited. Please pick a number between 1 and 235.
165.
What?
What?
There she is.
Hey, all right, we got a big show with
DENNIS QUAID coming up next. We'll be right back, guys.
Still ahead on Live, Ryan's mom cooks a Seacrest family favorite. From the series This Is Us, Sterling K. Brown. And coming up next, DENNIS QUAID.
William H. Macy will be here.
Yes, and from the new film Lion, Dev Patel also here.
Mm-hmm. And we finish up Live's. Now, I'm so excited about this. One of my favorite people will be here tomorrow, Live's Homestyle Thanksgiving Week. Gelman's mom, Rhoda, shares her recipe for gravy.
Yes, very special.
Wait a second. gentlemen, you allow gravy at the table?
Why would you say that?
Because he's very health conscious. Not a carb passes those lips.
We're gonna
good gravy.
We're gonna force oyster casserole
down his throat.
Down your throat in just a few minutes, Gal.
He's gonna pick out the casserole and only eat the oysters. All right, he's an incredibly charming and talented actor. Please welcome back to the show, Dennis Quaid. Gave you a hug. You are like solid muscle. What's your exercise
the
routine?
Stone. I ride the bike and I pump iron and I'm vain. I just won't let it go.
Yeah, it's definitely working for you. Do you ride a bike like I do, like a stationary bike,
or are you out on the road?
No, I put on that the silly lycra.
You do the whole
costume?
Look. Are you sponsored?
Road bike out there.
That's exciting. Yeah. Do you shave your legs and everything?
I tried it.
Yeah. Wasn't for you.
You do it so that you go faster, and also if you fall,
right?
The hair kind of.
That's not why I do it.
You
look at me. I do.
You shave for different reasons.
There's actual reason for it.
Oh, okay. I didn't know. But does it affect your golfing that you're lifting so much weight? Because I know you golf a lot.
It can.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's a lot? How much do you golf?
Only once a day, but.
Oh. Does Mark golf?
Not once in a while.
Yeah, for me, I don't understand it. I'm not good at it. And I can't. All my buddies want me to get out at 7 a.m. on a Saturday and play golf with a bunch of guys for 8 hours.
It's too early for me, man.
It's too early.
Day off?
Yeah, so. Yeah.
You should go golfing with Dennis. What time do you golf?
Oh, about 10, 10.
That 30. Sounds perfect.
I'll tell you what.
Stroll in.
I'll stroll in. I'll drive the cart. You golf.
Have you ever golfed at one of those really fancy, like, places overlooking a bluff with the ocean and thing? And
Yeah, I've done all that.
Like, what's the craziest place you've ever golfed?
Iceland.
Wow.
Yeah.
What's golfing like in Iceland? Slippery?
It's sort of like what St. Andrews, the first golf course probably was back in 1492. It's just basically a cow pasture.
I can play that.
I'm going to say
things.
I'm going to say words to you, and I don't necessarily know what I'm going to ask you. What's your handicap?
My swing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a 9 now. I was a scratch before the kids. And, but...
He just said words back.
Takes a lot of confidence.
Yeah, and I have no idea.
And you're supposed to respond with something intelligent.
That's incredible.
You know what we'll say?
That's amazing.
So you have 3 kids.
3 kids. Yeah, tell
us about
your kids.
Got it. We understand that. Tell us about your 3 kids.
It's a segue.
So your son is 24.
Yeah, Jack.
Yeah, Jack. Oh, my gosh, he's so handsome.
Yeah.
And those are your twins.
Yeah, those are the kids. They're both 9. They just turned 9 last week, the twins.
I can't believe they turned 9 already. I for some reason, I still imagine babies.
It goes by.
I know. Oh, my gosh.
It goes
even
by
for everybody
really
else. Yeah, it does.
Jack was a baby just yesterday, too, it seems.
But wow. And he's acting
grown
now.
Grown man.
He's acting now.
Yeah, he was in Hunger Games, and he was in Vinyl, Scorsese's Vinyl.
Yeah.
And from that, he just finished a Steven Soderbergh movie.
What's
is like
handicap?
Ocean's 11.
What's his handicap?
He doesn't play golf.
Okay, got it.
So scratch.
I think it's
scratch.
Good.
So that would be scratch.
More scratching with Dennis Quaid after this. Stay with us.
Stick around.
Evil.
That's Dennis Quaid in a scene from The Art of More. The Art of More. We are fascinated by this show for so many reasons, because we here at Live have a person in charge of our show named Art Moore. And at first, last year, we thought this was the story of his life. But in fact, you do not play Art Moore.
No. He should do a guest spot.
You play a real estate mogul.
I play a billionaire real estate tycoon in New York who has a penchant for politics.
Huh. And is this a reality show?
But,
this is scripted. I saw it.
Yeah, but all of the scripts were written, we did our first season, which was a year and a half ago, and we were 2 months into shooting when Trump announced that he was running for president, and then I started seeing my dialogue coming out of his mouth.
No kidding. Do you think he watches the show?
I doubt it.
That would kind of be amazing.
I think he really has time for it.
That would be amazing.
So Bruckner is the character, yeah?
Yeah, Sam Bruckner.
And so how diabolical will he be? How far will he go this
time? The Art of More is, it's myself, Kate Bosworth, Carrie Elwes, and this new kid, Christian Cook. Yeah. And it's delicious. It's about power and the lust for that and money and sex and set around the art world and the art auction house world in New York City. And people, they will do anything to get what they want.
It really is interesting. Once in a while, if you read any of the gossip columns in the New York papers, so many of the articles focus on
the auction world.
Yes, it really is really interesting. Now, you got to do something recently. You got to bang the gavel at the closing bell.
Yeah, yesterday.
Yeah,
that's very cool.
New York Stock Exchange.
That to me sounds better.
It was quite an honor to be down there on the floor.
There it is.
But on the third, boom.
You broke the gavel.
The thing, I mean, over there, you break it, you buy it.
So. In that room, I'd be worried about what you're buying.
I know, I'd really be worried. Unbelievable. Well,
40% of my net worth is over there. What are you talking about?
My gosh. No, was it a good day on the stock market?
It was kind of a flat day. A little bit. Okay. Kind of a flat.
Okay, but nothing terrible happened. So
no,
you're not
no,
a jinx
yeah,
besides breaking
fine.
The gavel.
Yeah.
All right. Well, listen, it's always so nice to see you. You should come by more often.
Sterling K. Brown. Nice to meet you, man.
Nice to meet you, too, brother.
Thank you for being here.
It's my pleasure.
We are fans.
Huge fans.
Oh, my goodness. Guys, I'm a fan. This is kind of overwhelming. This is
crazy. No,
wow.
Congratulations on all the success of OJ. My goodness.
Thank you.
I've got to tell you, I watched the trial in real time as it happened, and I forgot that you were an actor playing a character.
It's true.
You became Christopher Darden.
I appreciate that.
It really,
thanks.
I mean, I can't, you were you old enough to remember the trial? Did you?
Chop, please.
Well,
I mean, black don't crack, but yeah, I was old enough to remember the trial. I was a freshman in college at the time. And I remember like how I felt about Christopher Darden and being on the side of the defense. Right. And so it was really interesting 20 years later to actually walk through the prosecution's shoes, to see the evidence that they had, and to see all of the different pressures that were coming down on Chris and Marsha. They got vilified unfairly 20 years
ago. They really took a beating.
They took an absolute beating. So it was kind of nice to be able to reintroduce them to the public in a very different perspective. Hopefully they get a better shake.
It's tough to play a real person.
Yeah.
That's a lot of pressure.
It's not only is a real person, he's alive.
He's alive. Right.
He lives in the same city that I live in. No.
You spent no time.
We never met.
Did he give you feedback after you saw the episodes?
No, I haven't spoken to him.
Well, let's call him now.
You want to give him a call?
Better still, let's bring him out.
Here he is. Christopher Darden.
Just kidding. Just jokes. We don't have that kind of.
Good.
We don't have that kind of pull.
That would have been.
No,
you would have got me. You would have seen a black man blush. I would have turned deep red. Oh my God. But no, we never met.
But you've been studying acting a long time. I mean, you went to college.
I went to college at Stanford University, and I got my degree in drama there. Thank you.
You met your now wife there?
Yeah, my wife and I met freshman year. She was swooped up by a junior, so we didn't start dating like right from the beginning.
You were in the same dorm.
We were in the same dorm.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so I had time.
Yeah.
The long game.
You can work the long game.
The long game, it played itself out.
There you go.
Yeah.
Smart.
And then we both went to grad school at NYU. I lived here for about 8 years before I moved to LA. Yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic. And you have two sons.
I got two baby boys, a 5-year-old and a 1-year-old.
By the way.
Yeah.
Hold on. He delivered the first boy, right?
I did.
You did yourself.
Wait.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait. You want to hear this?
Wait, yeah, we do.
Okay, so.
Everybody gather around.
All right, guys, bring it in. My wife delivers quickly. Like, being pregnant's not her favorite thing, but, like, having the child, cool.
Right.
She had her first contraction at 11 p.m., and Andrew, our firstborn, came into the world at 2:23 a.m. the next day. Like,
okay.
3 hours, 23 minutes.
That's
first
crazy.
Child.
That's nuts.
So everybody says, like, you know, first child is going to take a little bit longer.
24 hours, 48 hours.
We're talking to our doula, and she's like, relax, have a glass of wine. It's going to be a big day tomorrow for you, mommy. Right? So she's trying to, like, take a shower, lay down, and then she's like, I got to go to the bathroom. So, like, that happens, like, three or four
times. That's a bad sign. I've seen this on Oprah.
And we were so trained. We went to, like, the birth class and everything, and the people told us, like, even if the birth sac or the mucous membrane breaks, that doesn't mean anything.
Means nothing.
So I would see the membrane. I saw the membrane. Sorry, this is kind of weird. I saw the membrane going down her leg, and I was like, oh, yeah, that's your plug.
Insane in
You'll
the
be
membrane.
Fine, right?
Right.
She comes crawling out of the bathroom after a while, and she says, I think I'm crowning. And I'm asleep, kind of. I was like, sweetheart, you can't be crowning.
Right.
It's your first baby. Just try to relax. Like, I'm telling this woman, I'm mansplaining what's happening to her. Right? So she's like, this joker knows nothing. She dials 911 and is trying to get the paramedics. And I'm on the phone with the midwife. And every time, like, I'm about to talk to the midwife, my wife has, like, her grad school acting contraction. And you just hear, ah. I was like, sweetheart, I can't hear the midwife. Basically, what's happening, she's on all fours. I look down, the baby's head is out.
Right. Yeah.
Just screeched up. The midwife's like, that's fantastic. Just wait for mommy to push again. Catch the baby so you can put him on mommy's chest and they can start bonding. And sure enough, my wife pushed a second time. His body just wriggled out, right? I had a hand on the back of his head and on his bum. He cried. Like, immediately. So I didn't have to, you know, rub him, make sure that he was breathing. She was on all fours.
Yeah.
She's on all fours.
Yeah.
So I have to grab the baby from
the
back.
No, you didn't say that. Because
I can stay here. I grab the baby from the back.
Okay.
You get the baby.
Yeah, you got it?
Okay.
You got it. You got
just
the baby.
Breathe. Just breathe.
Then you have to pass the baby through my legs.
Yes, I sure
so
do.
I get him right here.
Yeah.
I got him.
Yeah.
Undo the umbilical cord from around his leg, put him on mommy's chest, and then within seconds, you know, he's like bobbing around, looking for the breast.
By the way.
Yeah.
You both have kids. I do not. I'm totally confused with how this works.
Yeah,
it's confusing.
I'll tell you later.
Okay.
Well, I have a book for you.
Thank you.
I'm gonna say one thing. You can be the greatest storyteller of all time. Hit of 2016. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Everybody cries every episode.
It pulls something out of you.
Yeah.
It's the kind of show that sort of, whether you want to feel or not, it cracks your heart open and it demands that you feel everything. Mm-hmm. Whether it's joy, whether it's empathy. It's such a beautiful story about a family. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's very simple. It's complex in its storytelling, but it's really about these 30-somethings trying to figure out life and what to do next. And it's something that everybody can relate to.
He plays Randall. This is a show, my radio staff who watches everything,
yeah,
saw for the first time, and they were like, you've got to watch. They're obsessed.
Yes.
And
really?
Now so are we, obsessed as well.
Because, you know, you read that pilot episode.
Yeah.
Did you see it coming?
You know what I saw? It was written by Dan Fogelman, who wrote this wonderful movie, Crazy Stupid Love.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And I knew, reading the script, I said, this is the best network television pilot that I've had the privilege of reading.
Yeah.
Right? I've seen other things, but I got a chance to read it, and this was amazing. And I was still shooting The People versus OJ. And I think I was sitting at the prosecution table while this was, like, covering all the stuff in the courtroom, and I was talking to Paulson. I was like, Sarah, I think I found something that I would be really proud to be a part of.
Wow.
And she's like, yeah? I was like, brother's got to get a job. I don't know what y'all were trying to do. You know what I mean? Yeah, I ain't getting offers like y'all is, so if I can get myself a job, I'm gonna do it. So I was just like going over the script, trying to memorize lines, so when I got ready for the audition, it was popping.
Listen,
it
worked out. If that doesn't work out, you could be an amazing midwife.
Yes,
thank you.
Seacrest, my mom in the kitchen cooking for us.
Hey, you know what? We all know our next guest is a good mom because just look at my co-host today. The proof is in the pudding. The question is she a good cook? We're about to find out when she makes the Seacrest family favorite oyster casserole. Please welcome Ryan's mom, Connie Seacrest. Hi, Connie. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Mama.
Hey.
You look beautiful.
I sure do like your son, by the way.
I do too.
Oh, good. That's helpful. Now, what are we cooking today? Because I've never heard of oyster casserole, but it sounds delicious.
Okay, so once upon a time, Ryan got bored with regular stuffing.
I get bored. Stuffing makes me.
Yeah, you know,
I wanted
very,
some pizzazz.
Yeah.
So we had to do a little research and improvise and find something that would break up that turkey taste.
Right. Yeah.
So he loves oysters. So here we go.
I love oysters.
I love oysters too.
I love them.
Okay.
So
here we go. Get to work.
What do I do?
Put us to work.
First, you have to take off the crust.
Okay. Take off the
bread.
All right. So just only the white part of the bread.
Only the white part.
I got
that. Be careful.
Good job, Ryan.
You know, I don't know about your knife skills.
Yes.
Okay.
We have amazing. What should I do?
You got to get. Yes. You got to get that.
You want it like sliced?
I want it minced.
Minced. You got it. Okay.
Of course.
We do this as a team usually Thanksgiving. Mom's directing.
Yeah. We just need the. You got it. So we mince that up.
You got it. Here we go.
Okay. How are you doing? Okay, right.
Yeah.
Just cube a little bit of that up. We only need 1 1/2 cups.
Okay.
Put that in your little processor.
I'm not good at these machines.
What was Ryan like as a child?
A handful.
A handful?
Okay, can you...
Just like I am today.
Did he go through puberty?
Are we good? Are we good?
Why would you ask that?
Because I'm curious. I did. I want to know if he...
Okay,
did.
They're going to be a little slow.
Yeah, I'm still trying to go through it.
Me too.
Get the butter in the pan. Here we go. Wow, this is going great.
Honey, check out these knife skills.
Quite a bit of butter there, Mom.
Yep. Well, this is a holiday.
Yeah.
Holidays, there are no rules.
Can I do the pan thing?
Yeah, yeah.
That
we'll
like
get to
do?
That, honey. Could you do the crumbs first?
Yeah, I'm doing the crumbs. All right, is this enough?
No, do it now.
All right.
Put it in.
I mean, I'm on TV. I got to keep a schedule.
Do you have to do all of the cooking in your house for Thanksgiving?
He's going to do that. All right. All right, Ryan.
Put the sink.
Honey, I'm going to save the day. Here they are.
Oh, perfect. Oh. So these would,
First, we're going to do the scallions. All right. Scallions going.
These machines you guys have are impossible.
They're not impossible.
They are impossible.
It's
okay. Can I do this?
Yep.
It's done, Kelly. It's over here. I got it.
I'm determined.
Oh, wait a minute. Kelly. Hey, Kelly, could you preheat the oven at 450?
I sure can.
Good job, Mom. Great. Yeah.
This is his favorite part.
This is my favorite part.
Yeah,
oh my gosh,
try not to make a mess. I still need the crumbs, okay?
That's amazing. Right. You have flipping skills.
Flipping skills is all I do. I can't work the machines. Okay, keep going, Mom.
Okay, good.
Okay.
So now, what's next?
A little salt and pepper.
Oh, yeah.
You like it salty?
Okay.
I do.
Here we go. I'm going to help you out here.
Okay.
So here you go.
It's hot.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is the floor.
Kelly, floor?
That's the floor.
The floor.
I'm going to put the floor.
Okay.
This is the basin. We don't have to oil the pan or anything.
Where are my oysters?
Casserole, right?
Oysters.
Who's got the oysters? In the fridge, I bet.
It's just like home.
There they are.
All right. I want to do is go to the Seacrest house for dinner. I don't care what it takes. I'm showing up for Thanksgiving.
Okay, honey, put the oysters on top. Oh, no. Only half.
Wait, should we finish this after the break? All right.
We're going to take the break. Seacrest and we'll return.
You want to know more? Visit livekelly.com.
Back making the famous Seacrest oyster casserole.
Wait, where do you get the oysters? Do you shuck them yourself or what?
No, you can get them in
a container.
Can and then just drain
them.
They're
pre-shucked.
No kidding.
But they're really organic or something.
Oh, great. Yeah. I don't like shucking the oysters.
No, that's
our part. Right. You can hurt yourself. All right, this is very easy. So we put the stuffing on the bottom. Now we're going to put the on the top.
This is the ceiling.
This is where I screwed it all up last week.
You put the floor in with the ceiling.
I put the ceiling.
And the oven's been preheated, Mom?
450 for 15 minutes.
Okay, so
butter on top.
Okay.
Butter.
Okay.
And then?
And we bake it for 5 minutes.
Five minutes.
Ryan, we have one done in the oven down here.
And then magically, here it is. That is so much better than regular stuffing.
And you got to make sure it's brown and bubbly.
But it's quick. It's only 5 minutes because the oven's so hot. It's been preheated.
Exactly.
Mom, you're such a skillful
cook. Guys, I've got bad news. The cake from yesterday is still in the oven.
All right, let's taste it. Here you go.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Now taste.
Did you get one? Okay.
You got to get an oyster. Make sure you get an oyster.
So what do we think?
Good, right? You like oysters.
Delicious. I love it.
Mom, amazing.
Love it.
Love you. Great job.
Hey, Connie, thank you so much for being here. We really enjoy having you here. Come visit us again more often.
She loved the free trip. Don't worry.
Yeah, okay. Thank you so much. On tomorrow's show, William H. Macy will be here.
Jeff Patel as well.
How did you just do that? You're on the air. He's like, I don't know. I can use both sides of my thumbs and brain. And so, and I have a lot of friends that are high functioning that can really, really dial in and do their jobs and respond to you. And they are just a higher elevated people. I am mid to low level functioning.
Oh, let me tell you. Last night you responded every time very quickly.
That was accidental. I was having a good day. But there are times where it could take me 24, 48 hours to respond to something. So
I'm going to try and become you.
Okay, good.
I'm going to try that.
All right. Well, but anyway, back to the lady. 37% would rather have sex than Wi-Fi, and 14% would... 37.
I don't even care about Wi-Fi.
She doesn't care.
All right, she doesn't care about Wi-Fi at all. And 14% choose chocolate. All right. There you go. Okay.
I like her. She's comfortable in her own skin.
Yeah. I like her too. You two are going to make a nice couple. I'm excited about it. Yeah.
All right. What do we have today? Today on the show, we got Dennis Quaid is here.
Dennis Quaid is here. Who else? Tell me everything.
I'll tell you everything I know.
Ryan, everybody that's here today. Tell me everybody.
I think also from This Is Us, Sterling K. Brown.
Oh,
this
my
is
God.
Us.
Yes, and from OJ, yeah. He played Christopher Darden.
Yes. Amazing. Yes. That series, amazing.
Yep. And we continue Live's home style Thanksgiving week when Ryan's mom shares her favorite recipe for Christmas.
Very exciting.
Here's what I like best about the Seacrest. This is my number one like about the Seacrest.
She's so excited
to see you. Cheese-eating family. You like cheese.
Yeah. We're Swiss.
I'm not Swiss, but I should be because I love cheese so much.
I've made a whole career out of being cheese.
I disagree.
All right.
I disagree. Okay, you ready? It's time.
Not the crew. They're laughing. Are we ready?
Laugh at anything.
Okay, here we go.
It's time for Lives of Party Travel Trivia.
Let's do it.
Levy from Belmore, New York. Good job, Trisha.
Nice moves.
Good job. You look adorable. Were you preparing to be our trivia dancer today? Yes. Atta girl. I still have confetti in here.
You're happy
to be
here.
Guys, I only half fired my wand. Woo. Hey, let's say hi to Robin Nicholson from Rochester Hills, Michigan.
Hello, Robin, how are you?
Doing well. Good morning, Kelly and Ryan.
Good morning. How are you, Robin?
I'm doing great. I'm going to be putting up Christmas decorations today outside because it's a beautiful day in Michigan.
Oh, great.
Is that a picture of today?
Oh, no. Oh. That is a picture of Walt Disney World in February.
Okay. Oh. That was my second guess, actually.
Oh, yeah, I can see now the big...
The Epcot
Center. Yes, so cool. All right, let's spin the wheel, see what you're playing.
All right, here we go.
And win your trick. Okay, thank you. Regency Huntington Beach Resort and Spa in California. 7 days, 6 nights. It includes is one spa treatment per person. This trip is provided in part by Hotels.com. It's a prize valued at $4,400. You have 20 seconds and only one guess. Robin, good luck.
Okay, thank here you. We go, Robin. Focus now.
Okay.
All right. Earlier this week, Robert Wagner appeared on the show. What actor did Robert say played his son on television? Here we go. Clock is ticking.
Oh, my God.
Moaning is a good sign. It's coming.
Robert Wagner's son.
Yeah. On television.
TV.
5 seconds.
Take a guess.
I don't know.
Oh, my God.
What's your son's name?
Robert.
Oh, your son's name's Robert? It's not Robert.
No.
Sorry.
It's Michael Weatherly.
You know that.
Oh, yes. My gosh. The guy from Bowl. Yes. Oh.
Yes.
I know. See how it all comes to you after we give you the answer?
No.
Listen, Robin, you're still going to get a great prize. You and a lucky member of our studio audience will each receive a $500 gift card from Walmart.
Nice.
So please pick a number. Sorry, Walmart photo.
Yes.
Didn't want you to get too excited. Please pick a number between 1 and 235.
165.
What?
What?
There she is.
All right, we got a big show with
DENNIS QUAID coming up next. We'll be right back, guys.
Still ahead on Live, Ryan's mom cooks a Seacrest family favorite. From the series This Is Us, Sterling K. Brown. And coming up next, DENNIS QUAID.
Will be here.
Yes, and from the new film Lion, Dev Patel also here. Mm-hmm.
And we finish up Lives. Now, I'm so excited about this. One of my favorite people will be here tomorrow, Lives Homestyle Thanksgiving Week. Gelman's mom, Rhoda, shares her recipe for gravy.
Yes, very special.
Wait a second. Gelman, you allow gravy at the table?
Why would you say that?
Because he's very health conscious, not a carb passes those lips.
We're going to...
Good gravy.
We're going to force oyster casserole...
Down his throat.
Down your throat in just a few minutes, Gelman.
He's going to pick out the casserole and only eat the oysters. Say. All right, he's an incredibly charming and talented actor. Please welcome back to the show, DENNIS QUAID.
Nice to meet you, too, brother.
Thank you for being here.
It's my pleasure.
We are fans.
Huge fans.
Oh, my goodness. Guys, I'm a fan. This is kind of overwhelming. This is
Congratulations on all the success of OJ. My goodness.
Thank you.
I've got to tell you, I watched the trial in real time as it happened, and I forgot that you were an actor playing a character.
It's true.
You became Christopher Darden.
I appreciate that.
It really, thanks. I mean, I can't, were you old enough to remember the trial? Did you?
Chop, please. Black don't crack, but yeah, I'm going around. I was old enough to remember the trial. I was a freshman in college at the time, and I remember like how I felt about Christopher Darden and being on the side of the defense. And so it was really interesting 20 years later to actually walk through the prosecution's shoes to see the evidence that they had and to see all of the different pressures that were coming down on Chris and Marsha. They got vilified unfairly 20 years
ago. They really took a beating.
They took an absolute beating. So it was kind of nice to be able to reintroduce them to the public in a very different perspective. Hopefully they get a better shake.
It's tough to play a real person.
Yeah.
That's a lot of pressure.
It's not only is a real person, he's alive.
Right.
He lives in the same city that I live in. No.
You spent no time.
We never met.
Did he give you feedback after you saw the episodes?
No, I haven't spoken to him.
Well, let's call him now.
You want to give him a call?
Better still, let's bring him out.
Here he is. Christopher Darden.
Just kidding. Just jokes. We don't have that kind of...
That would have been.
No,
you would have got me. You would have seen a black man blush. I would have turned deep red. Oh my God! We never met.
But you've been studying acting a long time. I mean, you went to college.
I went to college at Stanford University, and I got my degree in drama there. Thank you.
You met your now wife.
wife there?
Yeah, my wife and I met freshman year. She was swooped up by a junior, so we didn't start dating like right from the beginning.
But you were in the same dorm.
We were in the same dorm.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so I had time.
Yeah.
The long game.
You can work the long game.
The long game, it played itself out.
There you go.
Yeah.
Smart.
And then we both went to grad school at NYU. I lived here for about 8 years before I moved to LA. Yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic. And you have two sons.
I got two baby boys, a 5-year-old and a 1-year-old.
By the way.
Yeah.
Hold on. He delivered the first boy, right?
I did.
You did yourself.
Wait.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait.
You want to hear this?
Wait, yeah, we do.
Okay, so.
Everybody gather around.
All right, guys, bring it in. My wife delivers quickly. Like, being pregnant's not her favorite thing, but like, having the child, cool.
Right.
She had her first contraction at 11 p.m., and Andrew, our firstborn, came into the world at 2:23 a.m. the next day. Like,
okay.
3 hours, 23 minutes.
That's
first
crazy.
Child.
That's nuts.
So everybody says, like, you know, first child is going to take a little bit longer.
24 hours, 48 hours.
We're talking to our doula, and she's like, relax, have a glass of wine. It's going to be a big day tomorrow for you, mommy. Right? So she's trying to, like, take a shower, lay down, and then she's like, I got to go to the bathroom. So, like, that happens, like, 3 or 4
times. That's a bad sign. I've seen this on Oprah.
And we were so trained. We went to, like, the birth class and everything, and the people told us, like, even if the birth sac or the mucous membrane breaks, that doesn't mean anything.
Means nothing.
So I would see the membrane. I saw the membrane. Sorry, this is kind of weird. I saw the membrane going down her leg, and I was like, oh, yeah, that's your plug.
Insane
You'll
in the
be
membrane.
Fine, right?
Right.
She comes crawling out of the bathroom after a while, and she says, I think I'm crowning. And I'm asleep, kind of. I was like, sweetheart, you can't be crowning.
Right.
It's your first baby. Just try to relax. I'm telling this woman, I'm mansplaining what's happening to her body. Right? So she's like, this joker knows nothing. She dials 911 and is trying to get the paramedics. And I'm on the phone with the midwife. And every time, like, I'm about to talk to the midwife, my wife has, like, her grad school acting contraction. And you just hear, ah. I was like, sweetheart, I can't hear the midwife. Basically, what's happening, she's on all fours. I look down, the baby's head is out.
Right. Yeah.
Just screeched up. The midwife's like, that's fantastic. Just wait for mommy to push again. Catch the baby so you can put him on mommy's chest and they can start bonding. And sure enough, my wife pushed a second time. His body just wriggled out, right? I had a hand on the back of his head and on his bum. He cried. Like, immediately, so I didn't have to, you know, rub him, make sure that he was breathing. She was on all fours.
Yeah.
She's on all fours.
Yeah.
To grab the baby from
the back. No, you can stay in that
position. I can stay here. I grab the baby from the back.
Okay.
You get the baby.
Okay.
You got it?
Okay.
You got
just
the baby.
Just breathe.
Then you have to pass the baby through my legs.
Yes, I sure
so
do.
I hit him right here.
Yeah.
I got him.
Yeah.
Undo the umbilical cord from around his leg, put him on mommy's chest, and then within seconds, you know, he's like bobbing around, looking for the breast.
By the way.
Yeah.
You both have kids. I do not. I'm totally confused with how this works.
Yeah,
it's confusing.
I'll tell you later.
Okay.
Well, I have a book for you.
Thank you.
I'm gonna say one thing. You can be the greatest storyteller of all time. Hit of 2016. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Everybody cries every episode.
It pulls something out of you.
Yeah.
It's the kind of show that sort of, whether you want to feel or not, it cracks your heart open and it demands that you feel everything. Mm-hmm. Whether it's joy, whether it's empathy. It's such a beautiful story about a family. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's very simple. It's complex in its storytelling, but it's really about these 30-somethings trying to figure out life and what to do next. And it's something that everybody can relate to.
He plays Randall. This is a show, my radio staff who watches everything, saw it for the first time, and they were like, you've got to watch. They're obsessed.
Yes.
And now so are we.
Silence.
And so today, in the paper, he's now saying he cannot accept in person because he is booked. So he's unavailable to receive the Nobel Peace Prize.
He's got a gig.
Have you ever met Bob Dylan?
No. Have you? Yes, you've met everyone. tell us, Ryan, tell us everything.
So I can tell you everything, but not because I've met him.
Okay.
Bob and I have the same dentist. Oh. Yes, even better than knowing him, dentist.
That actually is better than knowing him.
And so I don't want to out the dentist, but I've been going to him for a long time. He's since retired recently, but every time you go in, you got Bob Dylan pictures all over the wall, and he'll tell you great stories about Bob Dylan.
That's incredible.
None of which I can tell on this show because it's live.
Right.
But it's my closest connection. I've never met the man.
Oh my gosh, I don't even know what I would say to him if I met him.
I don't think we would understand what he would say to us.
I know we wouldn't understand him anyway. Yeah, I would love to meet him though. That would be a
total legend.
He's a person that, you know, doing this job, you meet a lot of people. And eventually, you meet a lot of people who know a lot of people. So eventually, you'll hear stories from people who know people who know people. Radio silence with Bob Dylan. I don't know a single person that knows him or has met him.
Next time you need a teeth cleaning, you know exactly what to sign you up, Kelly. Yeah.
So you're closer than I am to Bob Dylan.
One dentist away.
Gosh, these dentists, man, they know stuff. They know things. You know, because my dentist has told me stories about...
Gossip
about...
Give us some good gossip.
Well, no, I just know there's a group, I know a group, and I can't tell you the group, but the group...
Bon Jovi.
No.
It's Bon Jovi.
I know. Everything to me is Bon Jovi because I'm from New Jersey. So I'm like, I know a group and they're like, Bon Jovi.
For sure.
Okay. No, not that group. But he said that they would come in and do the laughing gas and then write songs. And they thought they were writing like genius, lyrical genius stuff. And then they would come out of the laughing gas and it was gibberish. Like they were writing gibberish. Nothing made sense.
Def Leppard? I'm trying to figure it out. All right, so Thanksgiving is, a week away? Can you believe that? Thanksgiving a week away.
A week away! I know, I'm excited for your mom's recipe, by the way. This is something I've never had before.
As a kid, I thought stuffing was boring, so we came up with this oyster casserole stuffing, which you'll see. It may sound a little gross, but just bear with us. So almost 50 million Americans expected to travel this year for Thanksgiving, which is, that's a lot. And something I wanted to run by you was, when you travel in the air, they have this list of do's and don'ts in the paper today.
Yeah, okay.
This is an air travel don't column. Don't do yoga in the galley. Do you ever do yoga when you get... Do you ever get stiff and do yoga in the galley?
I have not done yoga in the galley.
No tree out there in the...
No. Huh?
Okay. No tree with the ankles?
I don't believe anybody wants to see my crotch.
have you ever seen people, though, get up and stretch?
I've seen a lot of things on... Listen, there's an entire Instagram page called Passenger Shaming.
Passenger shaming. I've heard you talk about
this. I'm telling you.
You're obsessed.
It's my husband follows them and I stalk them because I haven't committed fully to the follow because I know that if I do, I'll never be able to travel again. Yeah. But they shame passengers who do disgusting things.
Like, give us a good example of something totally disgusting.
Like clipping their toenails. Clipping their toenails.
Funny you should mention that.
You see another passenger's head, like, because there's a head here and the foot's up here and the person's clipping.
Oh, and that's disgusting.
Who's taking that picture?
But that's on the list. It says don't clip your toenails. Yeah. It says do clip your toenails in the bathroom.
Or at home.
Yeah, maybe before you go. Good idea. Even better. Even better.
Or at home. It's like, geez, I really, really need a pedicure. I'm going to wait for that JetBlue flight. I'm going to wait. You know what? I've got all this time here at home.
No, not now.
I'm going to wait.
Wait for some connections.
Because I definitely may need to utilize my toenails when I go through airport security. So I'm going to, I'm going to
42,000 feet and personal hygiene, the perfect combination.
Yeah. Now going home, when you go home, when I go home to visit my parents, even though they have the Wi-Fi and it's plugged in over there. This is what they say. Because I'm like, you guys don't have Wi-Fi? And they're like, yeah, we do. It's plugged in over there. But we're not sure how to get on it or how it works. But they keep pointing.
So they're pointing. They point over there.
Uh-huh. And they go, it's plugged in right over there.
But shouldn't it work from right over here?
They don't know their passcode and they don't even know what that means. So anyway, so there's that. And so they're saying that people crave Wi-Fi more than chocolate alcohol, and sex.
Wow.
And
two out of three.
Okay, lady in the audience, you're an expert. Which one do you crave more than Wi-Fi, chocolate, alcohol, or sex?
I would rather have the sex, I'm sorry.
She said she would rather have the sex. Ask her if she's single.
Lady, are you single? Ryan would like to know.
My mom's in town, but she goes to bed early.
I'll take your mom out tonight. I'll take her out tonight.
Good team effort.
Her out on town. Okay, good. Good for you. Lady, you stay right there.
Yes.
Do not move. Yeah, so isn't that amazing that 40% said they would choose Wi-Fi?
We jones with our phone. I mean, we need to be connected at all times.
I love to not be connected, though.
You do?
I love to disconnect. So, I'm a good disconnector.
I'm going to try and do for my resolution for New Year's a digital diet where I don't check my phone for a half day or a day.
But you're a high-functioning person.
What is that?
So there are people in the world that are high-functioning.
I'm confused.
No, I'm going to tell you. The most successful people in the world that I've known, my most successful friends, of which I consider you one.
Oh, thank you.
You
get new friends.
You email them or you text them and they respond almost instantaneously in real time. Text message Anderson Cooper. He could be in the middle of a broadcast and you see him like broadcast.
By the way, that is
true. And you know he's responding to you in real time. And I go, how?
He's
wild.
Yeah, he is.
I have to ask you. I just gave you a hug. You are like solid muscle. What's your exercise
the
routine?
Stone. I ride the bike and I pump iron and I'm vain. I just won't let it go.
Yeah, it's definitely working for you. Do you ride a bike like I do, like a stationary
bike? Stationary, or are you out on the road?
No, I put on that the silly lycra.
You
know,
the you do the whole
costume?
Look?
Yeah.
Are you sponsored?
Road bike out there.
That's exciting. Yeah. Do you shave your legs and everything?
I tried it.
Yeah. Wasn't for you?
You do it just so that you go faster, and also if you fall,
right?
The hair kind of.
That's not why I do it.
You
don't look at me. I do
it. You shave for different reasons.
There's actual reason for it.
Oh, okay. I didn't know. But does it affect your golfing that you're lifting so much weight? Because I know you golf a lot.
It can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's a lot? How much do you golf?
Only once a day, but.
Oh. Does Mark golf?
Not once in a while.
Yeah, I don't understand it. I'm not good at it. And I can't. All my buddies want me to get out at 7 a.m. on a Saturday and play golf with a bunch of guys for 8 hours.
It's too early for me, man.
It's too early.
Okay, y'all.
Yeah, so. Yeah.
You should go golfing with Dennis. What time do you golf?
Oh, about 10, 10.
That 30. Sounds perfect.
I'll tell you what.
Stroll in.
I'll stroll in. I'll drive the cart. You golf.
Have you ever golfed at one of those really fancy, like, places overlooking a bluff with the ocean and thing? And
Yeah, I've done all that.
Like, what's the craziest place you've ever golfed?
Iceland.
Wow. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
What's golfing like in Iceland? Slippery?
It's sort of like what St. Andrews, the first golf course probably was back in 1492. It's just basically a cow pasture.
I could play that.
I'm going to say, words to you, and I don't necessarily know what I'm going to ask you. What's your handicap?
My swing.
Yeah,
I'm a 9 now. I was a scratch before the kids. But
he just said words back.
Takes a lot of confidence.
Yeah. And I have no idea.
And we're supposed to respond with something intelligent.
That's incredible.
You know what we'll say?
That's
you know what
amazing.
Say? So you have three kids.
Tell
got
us
it.
About
we understand
kids.
That. Tell us about your
it's
three
a segue.
Kids.
So your son is 24.
Yeah, Jack.
Oh my gosh, he's so handsome.
Yeah.
And those are your twins.
Yeah, those are the kids. They're both 9. They just turned 9 last week, the twins.
I can't believe they turned 9 already. For some reason, I still imagine babies.
It goes by.
I know. Oh, my gosh.
It goes
even
by.
Even for everybody
really
else. Yeah, it does.
Jack was a baby just yesterday, too, it seems.
But wow. And he's acting
grown
now.
Man.
He's acting now.
Yeah, he was in Hunger Games, and he was in Vinyl, Scorsese's Vinyl.
Yeah.
And from that, he just finished a Steven Soderbergh movie,
which
is like
handicap?
Ocean's 11.
What's his handicap?
He doesn't play golf.
Okay, got it.
So scratch.
I think it's
scratch.
That good.
So that would be scratch.
More scratching with Dennis Quaid after this.
Stick around.
evil.
That's Dennis Quaid, and it's seen from The Art of More. The Art of More. We are fascinated by this show for so many reasons, because we here at Live have a person in charge of our show named Art Moore. And at first, last year, we thought this was the story of his life. But in fact, you do not play Art Moore.
No, I do. He should do a guest spot.
You play a real estate mogul.
I play a billionaire real estate tycoon in New York who has a penchant for politics.
Huh. And this is a reality show? But, this is scripted. I saw it.
Yeah, but all of the scripts are written. We did our first season, which was a year and a half ago, yeah. And we were 2 months into shooting when Trump announced that he was running for president, and then I started seeing my dialogue coming out of his mouth.
No kidding. Do you think he watches the show?
I doubt it.
That would kind of be amazing.
He really has time for it.
That would be amazing.
So Bruckner is the character, yeah?
Yeah, Sam Bruckner.
And so how diabolical will he be? How far will he go this
time? The Art of More is, it's myself, Kate Bosworth, Carrie Elwes, and his new kid, Christian Cook. Yeah. And it's delicious. It's about power and the lust for that, and money and sex, and set around the art world, in the art auction house world in New York City. And people, they will do anything to get what they want.
It really is interesting. I mean, once in a while, if you read any of the gossip columns in the New York papers, so many of the articles focus on
the auction world.
Yes, it really is really interesting. Now, you got to do something recently. You got to bang the gavel at the closing bell.
Yeah, yesterday.
Yeah,
that's very cool.
The New York Stock Exchange.
That to me sounds better.
It was quite an honor to be down there on the floor.
There it is.
But on the third, boom.
Oh, you broke the gavel.
The thing, over there, you break it, you buy it.
In that room, I'd be worried about what you're buying.
I know, I'd really be worried. Unbelievable. Well,
40% of my net worth is over there. What are you talking about?
My gosh. No, was it a good day on the stock market?
It was kind of a flat day. A little bit, kind of a flat.
Okay, but nothing terrible happened. So
no,
you're not a jinx besides breaking
fine.
The gavel.
Yeah.
All right, well, listen, it's always so nice to see you. You should come by more often.
From Sterling K. Brown. Nice to meet you,
Ryan Seacrest.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. I gotta tell you, that was really nice. I think Seacrest gave me a back rub for a second, and I settled right in. Hey, it's Thursday, November 17th, and Ryan Seacrest is back today.
Good to be here. Thank you very much.
Amazing.
Well, thank you.
I love everything you're wearing right now.
Well, I appreciate that. I can only wear turtlenecks here on the East Coast, so I will not be able to wear this in Los Angeles.
I'm afraid to ever wear a turtleneck again because I wore a turtleneck yesterday on the show, and there were so many comments about how big my head looks.
So I actually noticed that you wore one yesterday, which is why I felt comfortable wearing one today, but I might get the same kind of comment.
Don't be alarmed.
I think my head looks small in this, though. It swallows me a little bit.
I do have
my head is not that small.
It's smaller than
Kelly's.
Well, everybody's head, Macy's floats are smaller than my head. I have a large head. I'm amazed my mom survived childbirth.
I have a fashion question for you as a woman, because I'm confused about men and socks.
Okay.
So my mother, who's here, you'll meet her later. She's going to cook oyster casserole. Connie Seacrest.
She got my dad and I these little booties that you put in your shoes
yes.
so you don't look like you're wearing socks. So so today, I don't know if you can see.
I like it. I like it very much. It's very...
Put my feet on the table?
Yes, put your feet on the
today,
table.
Today, I'm wearing the yeah. booties, but...
Yeah. Can you get the ankle shot? Can we get...
There you go.
Oh, look at
so,
that. Good
and I see every... Yeah. Every once in a while, I see men doing this. I'm not so sure this is my look.
You know...
Summary look.
You're a...
Am I late in the season?
Yeah, turtlenecks and that stuff.
Turtlenecks and ankles don't go together, Art? All right,
well,
thank
listen,
you.
Well, listen, I don't listen
oh, the,
to them.
The fashionista, over, well, he does look pretty good.
I wouldn't listen to anything
so what do you think?
Over here. I think, okay, so let me just say this. If you really want to master the art of not wearing socks, you've got to look at Bryant Gumbel. Bryant Gumbel is one of these formal, put-together fellows, such as yourself, Natalie attired, really polished.
Right.
And he has mastered the art of not wearing a sock.
Okay, so.
And you've got to see the way he does
so
it.
Real sports.
Real sports. Check it out. He does it in a way that is very, very, very effortless, and it all makes sense. You're almost there.
I'm almost
I'm not
there.
Sure if... I'm not sure if these shoes with the no socks
okay.
work. I'm not sure. I'm
in
not
the
sure.
first commercial, I'll change for you.
Okay, we should. That would be fun to do, though, by the way.
Just change clothes?
Yeah, that would be fun.
How was your night last night?
It wasn't as fun as your night last night. We texted each other last night and exchanged photos with what we were both doing at that time.
Yours looked much more intense than mine.
Well, show everybody what you did.
Okay, so last night... The greatest thing in the world is when you're at work, you're at your desk, and somebody sends flowers or a card, or you're in a restaurant, and someone sends over a bottle of boutique champagne, as did someone last night to my mother and I, who were on a mother-son date.
It's
called the Clam.
The Clam?
Yeah, where they serve seafood, imagine.
Wait, where is the Clam?
The Clam is West Village.
Okay.
So we walked, it was a beautiful night last night, we walked there, we sat down, and I said, well, who is that champagne from? The one and only Kelly Ripa.
I wanted to thank your that
thank
was really
you.
Nice of your mom to come in and do a cooking segment since my mom won't.
and your picture last night.
So anyway,
compare this.
He sends me this picture and I said, really, I wish I was with you two because this is what I've got going on. I'm soul cycling.
Well, so this you were spinning last night.
This was post soul cycle. That's why my hair is wet and my somehow sweat was still pouring out of my face.
You look beautiful even with the shine.
Oh, yeah. Thanks a lot.
I find it difficult to do this at night when you have to go to sleep.
I got really busy yesterday. My son is graduating eighth grade this year, and he's going to be going into high school, so we're trying to find a high school for him. So my husband and I have been taking high school tours.
Right.
So that pushed my entire... Usually I work out in the day. I don't like to work out when it's dark. It makes me somehow stay up all night eating food because I feel like I have to. I better eat another plate of ravioli. I sponge tonight. Yeah. So everything got pushed back late. That's why I was working out late because I don't typically do that.
Just so you know, we did not feel guilty. So
no, I know. I know. But you know what we did do last night after I got home? Mark and I finished binge watching Stranger Things.
Oh, yes.
Have you seen this show?
It takes place in the 80s.
Yes, it takes place in the 80s, so it appeals to... First of all, my kids are like, what is that? I'm like, that's a telephone.
That's great.
What is that supposed to be? Those are walkie-talkies. Like my kids, they think that this whole show takes place in outer space. I'm like, no, it's just the 80s.
Just a few years ago.
But it's a really good show.
Yeah, I started to watch that. I got through a couple. Do you normally binge? Do you get through a lot at once?
What we'll do is we will watch, like, in two to 3 days, we'll watch an entire season of something. Mm-hmm. That's what we do. Because we don't watch a lot of TV, just like certain things.
Just when you have a window of time to do it?
Yeah.
All right, so something I wanted to share with all of you and you, Ms. Ripa, I thought was interesting. In today's paper, I read this article. Mm. So Bob Dylan, you guys know Bob Dylan?
We've heard of him.
Yes.
He's an up-and-comer.
He is an up-and-comer. He was to be awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for Literature.
Yes, I think
first musician to win this.
That's kind of an amazing feat.
Huge. And so you would think that when you find out that you're going to win that, immediately you respond with some sort of press release or some sort of tweet or something.
Right.
He didn't. It took him a few weeks to acknowledge that he was going to get
this.
Wait,
they couldn't find him or something.
Yeah,
I kept following.
He was snorkeling somewhere. So he then eventually replied that he was speechless, so obviously very honored.
Hence the